Good morning, Middletown. Growing up disciple has always meant for me a mixed bag set of feelings related to World Communion Sunday, which is observed the first Sunday in October. Being a part of a tradition that centers weekly worship on the table defines me. So trying to relate to traditions that only set the table occasionally has always been a little off-putting. Observing communion is at the core of who we are, and so I've always been somewhat confused about communities that only brought out the communionware once a month or quarterly. One of my best friends in ministry at my former church was a United Methodist minister whose church campus was just south of ours. He was always amazed at the fact that we serve communion in all services, as his experience was that communion Sundays were lightly attended. Why? Because the service was 10 minutes longer. He also said that there were several people in his church that hadn't taken communion for years for just that reason, a slightly longer service. Now, when we talked about the meaning of communion, he and I had a similar understanding of the table, but for his church, it was an add-on to regular worship as opposed to the wonderful ending of a worship drama unfolding. So today, as we observe communion as a regular part of our experience, we also celebrate with our brothers and sisters in other traditions who might be doing the same thing, but with a smaller than normal crowd because it will add to their service time. I guess I don't get it because I was raised differently. Communion was never optional for me. In fact, if I worship in a tradition where communion is not a part of the service, I feel that I haven't really been to church at all. Now, obviously, we're in a Protestant minority here, as most denominations share in communion less frequently than we do. But it seems so apparent to me what Christ intended. Didn't he say that when two or more are gathered in my name, that this is what we're supposed to do? Did I somehow misunderstand that statement? About 30 years ago, there was a significant council created with our leadership, with leadership from our tradition, meeting with high-level leadership in the Roman Catholic Church. The first meetings were held in Rome. Now, to be very honest, in the greater scheme of things, the Catholic Church has no real reason to pay much attention to our small Protestant movement. They have hundreds of millions of members, while we have less than 1% of that. But what drew the Roman Catholic Church to desire conversations was our practice of communion. They too practiced regular communion, and we were one of the few mainline Protestant movements in the world that did. The discussion centered around our theological reasons for doing so, rather than who was welcome and what the elements represented. Those discussions have grown to other areas as well over the years, but started with the practice of weekly communion. One of the major differences between our movement and the Catholic Church centers around who is welcome at the table. The Catholic Church, you must be a member to receive Holy Communion, but in our tradition, at least in most of our churches, whoever believes in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior is welcome. It doesn't matter denominational background, life circumstances, or anything else other than a heart for Christ. The Catholics would say we are far too liberal with the table, and we would say in response that no human being can truly judge a heart. Only God can do that. Many of you who grew up in our tradition understand how important the open table is in defining who we are. If you've forgotten, let me refresh your memory. Both Thomas and Alexander Campbell, father and son and founders of our movement, rejected their former church because a council within the church determined whether or not a person was fit to receive communion. Each church could only determine for themselves and for that moment in time. If you were deemed fit, you were given a token to take to the church where you could use it to receive admittance to the table. Both father and son rejected this practice on the grounds that no man had the right to keep another from the table, celebrating God's grace and love for us all. This rejection of practice meant that both father and son were no longer deemed a part of the fellowship. Of course, they had rejected it already. While all of this might be helpful to understand who disciples profess to be, how is this truly played out in the way we function as faith communities? While we might not bar people from sharing in the Lord's Supper, our denomination and most of our churches have limited the way people could bring their God-given gifts to the community. Think of it in this way. If we believe that Jesus invites all who believe to the table and to the ministry of the church, why should we believe or practice that differently? When I was a youth several decades ago, my mother was nominated to be an elder in our home church. The church had existed for over 100 years, but she was the first woman invited to serve in this role. While she was a safe choice and was loved by the congregation, the day of the successful vote on the nomination slate, families left the church. One of those families was my father's business partner and a good friend for decades. And while my mother was valued as a Sunday school teacher and the children's music teacher, she was not wanted as an elder at the table that represents God's love and acceptance of all, at least by a few. Well, this has played out in our churches over my lifetime, and probably this one as well, with limitations placed on women or on divorced people, or on people gifted in their journey of sexuality, and on those who come from ethnic backgrounds not shared by the majority. I affirm this congregation's progress on many of these issues, but also wonder where we might be blind to the experience of those who don't truly feel welcome to express their gifts fully at Middletown, to those who have lovingly but intentionally been kept in their place. This month celebrates the LGBTQ+ community. Over the last 3 years, Middletown has made significant inroads in truly finding a place at the table for this community. But like anything that is still somewhat new, there is still a journey to take together, and how we truly open our hearts and arms to the community often kept outside the church walls. These last few weeks have also reminded us that race is an issue where we all have a blind side. We choose, for the most part, to live in our own bubbles, hoping and pretending that things are better. But the events of the last several weeks have reminded us how far we have to travel this difficult road. For we who claim Christ, the table is the place where we start claiming Christ's heart and looking honestly at the community who truly feels welcomed at all. But let us be honest, as we extend the welcome to the table to those maybe previously excluded, it also creates concern and tension within people who may be coming from a different theological perspective, who may begin to wonder if there still is a place for them. As much as the church tries to broaden the spectrum of those who claim our church home, too often this new openness feels like a shift in one direction, leaving some to feel no longer as welcome as they once were. This is what makes being an inclusive community so hard. The tension always exists, not because we want to keep others away, but because these issues of faith and practice sometimes leave us in uncomfortable places. And that's why this table is so important. Jesus didn't set it and then say to his disciples, you can all eat of this, but your brother-in-law isn't welcome because he doesn't meet my standards. Now, Jesus said all who believe, as imperfect and flawed as we are, have a place at this table. Let's be honest. Our movement is far from perfect. We don't have a well-defined methodology for how the church needs to operate or even believe. And many people get frustrated because of our lack of creedal statements, thinking we don't stand for anything. I always hesitate to preach from the pulpit as one who has the absolute answers in life, even though many churches do this quite successfully and grow because of us. This we can say with confidence, however. We believe that each person has an equal opportunity to understand Scripture as it speaks to them, and that there are no absolutes in some of the hot issues bannered around in society today. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that he is our salvation. We believe in a God that holds us accountable for our actions, but who also loves us in spite of them. And we believe in a table set not only on special occasions and not just for a selected few, but for all who believe. It is a table of abundance and grace, and it is set just as much for the strangers among us as it is for the old friends and family. Now, for those of you raised in another tradition, in a wonderful church community that you loved and that loved your family, I'm not judging you, nor am I questioning the depth of faith within your former tradition. Far from it. I truly believe that each tradition has a precious piece of God's intent for us. And when we finally get over the things that separate us, maybe then these individual pieces can make us holy, what God intended us to be in the first place. So it is in this movement, when we celebrate a common table set for all, and I rejoice in that fact. It is in this moment when, whether Republican or Independent or Democrat, or too tired and frustrated to be identified with any of them, it is in this moment, whether gay or straight, Black, Asian, Native American or white, conservative or liberal or somewhere in between, we all, for this moment in time, on this holy ground, are loved for who we are and are reminded of that in this gift of loving sacrifice and this welcome that extends beyond our limited understanding. This is the moment when we get it right. This is the moment when we almost are able to glimpse heaven. Who knows where our individual and collective journeys will take us? Who knows what our world will look like once we're able to get back to our new normal? But with all these questions, there is one thing you can know will never change. God loves you, and you are welcome at this table. And this will never change. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we know we come as imperfect and flawed people. We know we come to this table unworthy. But each and every time we come, we find you with your loving arms extended to welcome us back. To say that we are special and unique within your eyes. God, we thank you for this place that reminds us that we are all created in the Creator's image, and that we are all blessed by the one who loves us in spite of ourselves. These things we offer in humble prayer. Amen. Before we take communion this morning, I invite you to pause and reflect as we have music shared with us. Let your heart be moved and let your spirit be lifted, and then come back to the table so that we can share together.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee.
We are so privileged to come to this table as people who know we are loved and cared for. I referred to a practice that was going on within the Scottish Presbyterian Church at the time that Thomas and Alexander Campbell were leaders in those congregations, also searching through their own faith values. Let me remind you of what I said. To receive communion, to receive access to this table, you had to go before a board of elders. And they had a series of questions they would ask. And depending on your answers, they would determine whether you were worthy to come to this table. If you were not, you were sent away. But if you were considered worthy, they gave you one of these. This is a token from a Scottish church. It's 200 years old, but it represents what they would have received. It has the name of the church. It has a date on it of 1820. And this was what you could take. You would take and be met at the door, and you would hand them this token, and they would let you into the sanctuary to partake. Father and Son rejected that practice, and it has become a core value of who we are. No human being can stand in the way of another coming to this table of love. This table was set by Christ for all who believed. Our requirement is a belief in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's it. That's the only admittance, not a piece of metal stamped out with a date on it and the name of the church. No, just an open heart and a spirit of love. I invite you to get your elements, bread and the cup, and to share in the body of Christ as we come to this table. We know the story, Jesus gathering with his friends in a rented space away from the prying eyes of those who might do them harm. They had gathered there to celebrate the feast of Passover, to be reminded of God's love for a captive people. But following the celebration of that meal, Jesus did something new. He took bread, he held it in his hands, he broke it, and he gave it to his friends with these words: "Take and eat of it, each of you, for this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Come and share the bread. And after they ate the bread, Jesus took a cup. He held it in his hands. He said a blessing over it, and he gave it to his friends with these words: "Drink of this cup, each one of you, for this is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as well in remembrance of me." Drink of the blood and know of Christ's love for you this day. Amen.